I am rarely more productive than when I'm procrastinating, said one member. I might get the whole house clean because I'm putting off studying, or I'll get the bills done because I don't want to have a hard conversation. But all that effort spent on busy work doesn't get us closer to our goal. Sooner or later, we must admit the truth and deal with the thing we are avoiding. Most of the time, the avoidance takes much more energy than the doing. Efficiency is the result of clearing out that defective stuff that drains us of our time and energy. We strive for balance, and we find it in different ways. When we get more comfortable with ourselves, we are more comfortable with others as well. Our willingness and humility shows a genuine desire to do better, no matter how well we are doing, not because we have something to prove, but because we care. We can practice principles in the workplace without being naive or overly eager to please. As we stay clean, we develop a new history. Our colleagues may not have seen us in desperation and might have no reason to guess that we are addicts in recovery. We don't have to let go of our anonymity to integrate who we are into our careers. That's a choice we can make for ourselves. We are human beings, doing our best to be responsible and productive. Working can become an alibi for not practicing our program. We have heard many times that we will lose anything we put in front of our recovery, and many of us have experienced this with jobs or material things that seem to make recovery obsolete or inconvenient. When we are using the tools available to us, we can see the challenges we encounter in our work as opportunities to practice our program. Applying the principles never makes life worse. When we are not practicing our program, our problems become magnified unreasonably. We feel overly responsible, obsessed, and compelled to keep going, even when a break might be the thing that would give us needed perspective. We are successful members of society, in and out of the workforce. We have as much integrity toward our jobs and the people we serve outside the rooms as we do inside the rooms, and that's the point. When we practice these principles in all our affairs, we bring so much to the world. It's not just a theory or another awful lecture about our potential. It's our experience. It's what we do. Anonymity. Our addiction no longer sets us apart, but making the decision to tell people about our membership in NAS should be done with care. We can be recklessly casual about our anonymity. Living Clean Approval Draft for Decision at WSC 2012. Chapter 6, A New Way of Life. 109. Anonymous is half our name for a reason. There is still stigma attached to being an addict, and there may also be consequences to admitting we're in recovery. Caution isn't the only reason for anonymity. The 12th tradition tells us that it is our spiritual foundation. The fact that we are anonymous means that the work we do in NAS really can be selfless service. We don't want or need credit for helping others. It's what we do to save our own lives. We don't benefit from sympathy for our condition. The price for that is ultimately too high. In the rooms we are equals with one another, and out of the rooms we are equals with our peers. We check our motives before we share with someone that we are addicts, and we learn that this is good policy anytime we consider disclosing something significant about ourselves. Taking a moment to pray and consider our intentions frees us to use our experience as a tool rather than a weapon. consider whether we are seeking attention, making ourselves look important, trying to justify our behavior, or whether we are able to offer help or guidance as a result of our experience. We may be letting someone get to know us better, creating a bridge for empathy. We also want to consider our own boundaries. Is this someone we feel safe to share with? Would someone else's anonymity be compromised by our disclosure? Are we limiting or protecting the relationship by not sharing about ourselves? Is our action taking us outside the boundaries set for us by the 11th tradition? We have something to share that has value in and out of the rooms. It is ours, and we have choices about it. That said, there are times when it is appropriate to let go of our anonymity, and, of course, there are times when people find out through no action of our own. We have choices about how we want to respond. A member shared his experience. I had been keeping my non-membership a secret, but someone I had seen in meetings was friends with a rival at work. She told the rival and he told everyone. I was terrified, but the result was nothing. Now I'm free to be myself. I don't have to hide anymore. It can be uncomfortable or even frightening to feel that we carry our anonymity as a secret. Not hiding means that we can be ourselves, and also that we are free to carry the message when we see an opportunity. When we run into people we know from work or other contexts in non-meetings, we want to consider each other's anonymity. We might be comfortable sharing our membership with others, but this doesn't mean the other person is. Allowing each of us to experience our membership in our own way is part of the freedom we give one another. Just as we don't judge one another's desire to stop using, we cannot judge commitment or quality of membership based on a person's willingness to be known as a member. Learning to choose wisely and appropriately is important. We may be the only example of recovery someone ever sees, and our behavior is a reflection of our message. We want to consider this when we wear or carry non-memorabilia or put a non-sticker on our car. We are letting people know something about ourselves, and we are telling them about the fellowship as well. Our message is carried not just by what we say, but also by what we do. Likewise, each of us makes decisions for ourselves about what kind of environment we feel comfortable in. Some of us are never in the presence of drugs after we get clean. Others of us find that our obligations to work or our families may expose us to people who are using. What one member sees as an unnecessary risk, another may find an essential part of integrating. Living Clean Approval Draft for Decision at WSC 2012. 110. Back into society. It is important to remember that we always have the option to leave if a situation has gotten uncomfortable. When we share honestly about our lives, who we are and what we do become vital parts of our message of recovery. Our fellow members often take pride in our success, just as our family might. But we don't want to lose the foundation of equality that keeps us all alive and free. Knowing that each of us is no better or worse than any other member makes it easier to live with our past, and to begin to hope for our future. It also means that we can see our success as part of our lives, but not as our whole identity. A change in our status for better or worse doesn't have to destroy us. Our practice of anonymity means that we can continue to grow in good times and bad, and that we can continue to see the the benefit of practicing a program of recovery even when our lives are extraordinary. Honest self-assessment is essential to recovery, but it is only possible if we are vulnerable enough to let someone in. We choose those mirrors carefully, seeking those we can trust to be honest, helpful, and kind. This difficult process is made harder when we are admired for our accomplishments, profession, or social status. We may find that people are reluctant to tell us about our flaws. They may not even see them. When we treat a member as an icon rather than as another addict seeking recovery, we deprive them of the opportunity to experience the recovery they may desperately need. None of our members is more or less valuable than any other. When we forget this, we harm one another and the fellowship as a whole. The gift of hope. We have so much to offer. We are good listeners, and we know how to find the strength and hope in our experience. We are on a path and are conscious of our journey. In our own way, we are each loving, caring, and generous. NAS Boot Camp for Caring. We can learn more about empathy in our first year and not than most people do in a lifetime. What we learn about living in NAS is applicable outside as well, and we can be good friends to others whether they are in recovery or not. The tools and principles we learn here can serve others in and out of the fellowship. When we venture out, we get to discover how useful we can be. We learn from each other's examples. Those who go before us clear the path we walk today. We walk in one another's footprints as we progress on our journey. We learn responsibility by watching others be responsible. Telling the truth about ourselves doesn't just set us free, our example frees others. Even in our most painful moments, we can still be a vision of what is possible. If we are willing to include the people we sponsor and draw them closer as we go through an ordeal, they can offer support and reassurance we dearly need. We also give them the chance to learn from our experiences and our mistakes. We can be an example of strength and perseverance for others, and we can look to others for hope as well. When we find our place, we fit like a piece in a puzzle. It feels right. Recovering in complete creative freedom means that we can listen to our heart and our higher power, and follow that path wherever it leads. The first time we believe we can stay clean, we begin to understand that we have choices about our lives. But living out our choices takes courage, patience, and perseverance. We have to be willing to hang in there when it gets hard, and keep going when we're not sure we're getting anywhere. We keep doing what's necessary to Living Clean Approval Draft for Decision at WSC 2012. Chapter 6, A New Way of Life. 111. Care for ourselves as we move forward. The same tools that brought us freedom in the beginning can keep working if we continue to use them with the same willingness. We are loved and our lives have meaning today. We do remarkable things with our lives, sometimes by accomplishing big goals, and sometimes simply by being ourselves. A member complained to her sponsor that as a homemaker she felt she wasn't really doing enough with her life or her time, that maybe she should have done something more important. Her sponsor smiled, "Are you kidding? By breaking the cycle of addiction in your family, you're changing history." Our greatest achievements may not be the things anyone else ever knows about. The simple fact that we survive our own stories is monumental. that we go on to help others and live lives we can be proud of is beyond our wildest dreams. Whatever we do, we make a difference in the world because we are clean. Living Clean Approval Draft for Decision at WSC 2012. The journey continues. Awakenings. A spiritual awakening is just that, an awakening. We still have to get out of bed. Some people awaken for just a moment and then doze off again. If we want to stay awake and alive, if we want the miracle of recovery to continue to unfold in our lives, we find ways to put this awakening into action. If we are not carrying the message, we go to sleep again. We seem to awaken in stages, not all at once. We may not know it right away, but the first time we find hope is a spiritual awakening. Each of us experiences new awakenings as we examine our beliefs and practice living by them. Honesty, open-mindedness, and willingness are often the first spiritual principles we experiment with. We learn more principles as we go, and some become more important to us than others. Over time, we gain more experience with using them to guide our actions. Spirituality is progressive, dynamic, and creative. The foundation of our recovery is that we have to get out of ourselves in order to live. In early recovery, many of us move back and forth between genuine excitement at our new possibilities and sorrow for what we have lost. Some of us describe early recovery as a pink cloud, and others tell about a long season of grief. We experience many new feelings, sometimes very quickly. We grow and change, build and lose relationships, go to meetings, and we learn. Throughout our recovery, we experience new awakenings, new surrenders, and new freedoms. The simple principles we learn when we are beginning our recovery take on deeper meaning as we practice them in our lives. Just when we think we know all that recovery has to offer, more is revealed if we are willing to accept the gift. There is no substitute for time in recovery. It gives us a chance to heal, grow up, start over, and build lives that matter to us and to the people around us. The time itself doesn't heal us, grow us up, or start us over. What matters most are the actions we take. Consistent application of the tools of recovery changes us. The process is ongoing. We don't just work the steps, we come to live them. They shape how we think, how we feel, and how we respond to the world. The steps teach us to grow up and help others. We learn to love ourselves by speaking the truth. Accepting our assets is part of our amends to ourselves, but more importantly, it begins the process by which we make our amends to society. Humility is honesty about who and what we are. We come to see how much we have and how much we have to offer. There is a difference between being in the program and living the program. When we come to an understanding of this program for ourselves, it becomes our own, and it becomes a part of us. Building a spiritual life that we can grow with is a creative action. It requires that we practice, develop our beliefs, and apply them to our lives. Step 11 does not say, we maintain a conscious contact. It says, we sought to improve our conscious contact. When we practice our program, this relationship doesn't just get more important, it gets better. Our spiritual experience doesn't have to make sense to anyone but ourselves. Embracing the part of ourselves that is creative, that changes the things around us in a meaningful and positive way, is an act of self-acceptance that becomes visible in our lives. We discover that the things we care about and value the most reflect the will of our higher power for us. 112. Chapter 7. The journey continues. 113. Self-acceptance frees us to do the next right thing, or to wait peacefully for the next words or actions to emerge. When we are no longer in the middle of the storm, we begin to understand ourselves, our disease, and our recovery in different ways. We can be ourselves in the present moment without fear or apology, without the need for approval or justification. When dancers move through space with intention and beauty, we say they are graceful. In the same way, when we move through our lives with intention and gratitude, we demonstrate grace. When we crash from one self-willed experience to another, creating damage and confusion, we are disgraceful. If we are willing to return to humility and gratitude, our lives get easier. Even when we can't identify the next right thing, we can generally see the next wrong thing and stay away from it. When our spirituality leads us, we can move through our lives with ease. Our lives in recovery are so unlike what brought us here that we may not know what to do. Sometimes even achieving our goals can seem to make our lives unmanageable. Experience can be a mighty teacher. Awareness creates a foundation for new ideas. Life provides opportunities to put that new information into action. Adapting to new information can take time. Awareness that we are in possession of a precious gift changes how we see ourselves and our world. We experience grace. Joy and gratitude walk hand in hand. For some of us, joy is the sense that we are part of something much larger than ourselves, and more important than our immediate feelings and experiences. We matter, but we matter most when we are connecting with others. This deep sense of joy does not require that we be happy all the time. It's bigger than that. Humility means that we understand our place in the world. Joy comes from seeing that we have a purpose. Being spiritually awake, we can see the miracles that surround us, even when life is difficult. Generosity of spirit is the antidote for loneliness and alienation. Living our principles. Understanding is important, but it doesn't help much without application. We apply the principles, and we apply effort. We apply ourselves to changing our perspective and our lives. When things get difficult, it can be easy to forget that we already have a life we love and enjoy. We don't have to deny reality to have hope or gratitude. We feel what we feel, and we do the footwork anyway. We learn not to take our emotions quite so seriously. My feelings aren't facts, said a member, but I still feel them. When we choose not to look through the lens of resentment and entitlement, we can see the world as it is and find beauty in it even when it's challenging. Each day is filled with opportunities either to escape reality or to show up in life. Each of us works our program differently, and it changes for each of us over time. It might mean that we are writing, serving, attending meetings, or just that we are practicing a conscious contact with our higher power. Whatever it means for us, we have a responsibility to walk our talk. The idea that, if you want what we have, do what we do, has no expiration date. The awareness that we can always get better brings its own freedom. We we can see the changes in our lives and in our thinking, and we know that recovery works for us. The more we know, Living Clean Approval Draft for Decision at WSC 2012. 114. That, the more we can see what still needs to be done. We have ideas about what our lives are supposed to look like, by now, and we shame ourselves for not being there. We don't have to get caught up in ideas of where we should be. This is an issue in early recovery, but it comes back as we get some clean time. A member who was homeless on his 20th anniversary was ashamed to celebrate. What have I got to show the newcomer? He asked. That you can stay clean no matter what, came the reply. Acceptance frees us to share honestly about our lives without feeling that we have to fit into a model or be anyone other than who we are. Serenity doesn't mean that we don't experience dramatic events. It gives us the clarity of mind to go through them. No matter what happens, we can remain whole and joyful at our core. Our understanding of the steps deepens, and we start to see the possibilities they offer in new ways. The more we trust, the more our eyes are open. We are no longer so focused on what is wrong with us. We start to shift our attention to the assets we have and the hope we can see for ourselves. When we can separate hope from wishing or expectation, it stops feeling like such a setup. More and more we are driven by hope rather than fear. The gratitude we feel grows from relief at not having to use today to genuine appreciation for our lives as they are and as they can be. When we put gratitude into action, we see the world differently. A member shared, "My touch has come back. My smell and taste are alive. My children and grandchildren run into my arms and are safe there. People who come into my life go away with something good. The sense of wonder we experience in our own lives, as if we were seeing them for the first time, brings an array of feelings. Our hearts break for the harm we have caused, while at the same time we are filled with joy and gratitude for the gift of recovery. It is such a relief to be able to feel good again. Even pain is okay sometimes, it helps us feel human. But sometimes it seems like we don't have our hand on the emotional volume knob. When I started to feel, I had no control over my emotions," a member shared. "I learned different ways to deal with them over time. My sponsor taught me to name my feelings and had me create a written list of healthy things I could do when I was emotional. Our feelings won't consume us, even though it sometimes feels like they might. At some level it really doesn't matter what we feel. What matters is what we do. We no longer have to act on our impulses and emotions. We can make choices in our lives today about what we do and how we respond. We may still get depressed or frightened or angry, but our feelings don't have to take possession of us anymore. When we realize we've survived every emotion we ever had, we start to believe that we are going to be alright even when we don't feel alright. Our best lessons often come by looking back at our own bad behavior. Our regret helps us to find compassion for others and a sense of possibility for our new way of life. Getting some perspective means that we can put a little distance between our thoughts, our feelings, and our actions. Our feelings won't kill us, but denying them might. It's usually when we're trying to avoid a feeling that we act out, creating damage and confusion to divert attention. Admitting our feelings, even when we're judging ourselves for having them, is one way we practice honesty. Main approval draft for decision at WSC 2012. Chapter 7. The journey continues. 150.